some glad morning when this life is over. I'll fly away to a home on God's celestial shore. I'll fly away. Of this life and grown, I'll fly away. Like a bird from prison bars has flown, I'll fly away. I'll fly away, oh glory, I'll fly away. When I die, hallelujah, by and by, I'll fly away. Just a few more weary days and then I'll fly away to a land where joy shall never end. I'll fly away. I'll fly away, oh glory, I'll fly away. When I die, hallelujah, by and by, I'll fly away.
Already standing, I'm going to invite you to do so as we continue in worship.
As I travel through this pilgrim land, there is a friend who walks with me, leads me safely through the sinking sand. It is the Christ of Calvary. This would be my prayer, dear Lord, each day, that I would do the best I can. For I need thy light to guide me day and night. Blessed Jesus, hold my hand. Jesus, hold my hand. I need thee every hour. Through this pilgrim land, protect me by thy power. My feeble plea, oh Lord, look down on me. When I kneel in prayer, I hope to meet you there. Blessed Jesus, hold my hand. When I wander through the valley dim, towards the setting of the sun, lead me safely to the land of rest. If I a crown of life have won, I have put my faith in thee, dear Lord, that I would reach the golden strand. There's no other friend on whom I can depend. Blessed Jesus, hold my hand. Jesus, hold my hand. I need thee every hour. Through this pilgrim land, protect me by thy power. Hear my feeble plea, oh Lord, look down on me. When I kneel in prayer, I hope to meet you there. Blessed Jesus, hold my hand. When I kneel in prayer, I hope to meet you there. Blessed Jesus, hold my hand.
Man, you may be seated.
Good morning. I am Pastor Brian. I want to personally welcome you here this morning to the Lynchwood Church of God, and I want to share with you just a few things that I want everybody here to be aware of this morning. If you are a guest or visiting us for the first time, I want to invite you to our Welcome Center in the church foyer. We have a small gift we would like to give you, as well as provide any additional information about our church community that may be of help to you. The communication cards are located in the pews in front of you. Please keep us posted on your most up-to-date contact information. And if you're not receiving email updates from the office, be sure to check the box on the front of your card. On the back, we want to invite you to share prayer requests so that we can partner with you in prayer. These requests are prayed for weekly by the church staff. If you check the prayer ministry box, know that others in the church will be praying for you as well. And of course, be sure to check the confidential box for any private concerns you have. You can turn in your communication card at the Welcome Center or use the contribution boxes which are located in the church hallway. If you're interested in supporting Lynchwood financially, this is also where you can give by cash or by check. If you prefer to give electronically, please visit lynchwood.org, go to the side tab, and click the contribution link. Finally, we want you to know that we have a staffed nursery as well as a nursing area available for infants and small children. For children ages 4 to 11, you're going to be dismissed partway through the service for Children's Church. Parents, if you have a child that is going to participate in Children's Church, please make sure you sign them in each Sunday at the Child Check-In Station, which is located at the nursery. Again, I want to thank you so much for joining us this morning, and now we want to inform you of just a few more things that are currently happening in our church community.
Good morning. Good morning, everyone. I want to welcome you to Lynchwood Church of God, both those of you that are here in person and everyone watching online. So the last time I was up here doing announcements was this last summer. For those of you that remember, I told you guys about how my dad's been giving me a lot of advice lately, life advice, how to do these announcements well, stuff like that. And this time when I was home, his biggest piece of advice for me was, whatever you do, do not fly back to the state of Alabama during the college football national championship game. Well, I kind of messed that one up. I am flying back and landing around halftime. But I told my dad I had a really good plan. I have found the one Oregon Duck fan in the state of Alabama to come and pick me up at the airport. So I should be good to go there, but the rest of the state will probably be shut down. So to start up with announcements today, Christmas cards. There are still Christmas cards out in the mailbox here, and today is the last day that box will be out there. So for those of you who think you might have picked up your Christmas cards already, please go ahead and check again. Some people, like my family, drop our cards off late every once in a while. We kind of forget to put a few out, so please just double check that. Also, we've got photos just outside here on the tables from Live Nativity that Pastor John took. So there are two different tables. There are signs on them that tell you which photos you should take, which ones you shouldn't. Please take the ones from the table that are available. And please, everyone, pick all of that stuff up so I don't have to make this announcement again when I'm back in the summertime. Also, don't forget that we have link table conversations following the morning service. Everyone's invited to join outside here in the gym to have some discussion after today's sermon. And then we've got a weather alert reminder. So as we're in the winter months here now, if any weather, for whatever reason, closes down church on Sunday, there will be a notification posted by 8 a.m. that day. It'll be on the website, which is lynchwood.org, the Lynchwood Church of God Facebook page, or it'll be sent in an email to those of you guys that are on the church email list. So for those of you who don't have internet access, you can sign up at the Welcome Center out here to be put on the phone list. Please, this is only for people who do not have internet connection. If you do, please do not add your name to this list. So now I'd like to call Jackie Scott up to make a quick announcement about directories.
Alicia. So we're hoping to produce a revised, updated church directory soon, but I do need your help. We want to be sure that every person, every individual, every household that calls Lynchwood home is included in the directory. So what I'm asking you to do is, I'm in the information collection stage right now. So what I would like you to do is come by the next few Sundays. I'm going to be at the table next to the pastor's office with some lists, the working list that I'm using, and I want you to check your information to make sure it's accurate. Maybe you're not on there yet, or maybe you know of someone that shouldn't be on there. Just do some checking with me so that we have accurate information. And that will really be helpful to me. I'll be there. I've already had some people do that this morning, which is great. So I need everybody to help me with this. You will do that, won't you? Thank you.
Thanks, Jackie. So I kind of forgot to mention before I got up here. My name's Alicia Lewis, for those of you that don't know me or have forgotten me since I've been gone. My dad, Mark, was actually supposed to be doing the announcements today. I had a talk with Pastor Brian about this, though, and decided we probably shouldn't start off the new year with my Uncle Brad doing announcements and then my dad doing announcements back to back. That might kind of scare some people, so that's why you got me today. So a couple more announcements. This week is the OK's monthly lunch. So that's going to be this Tuesday, January 11th at noon in the gym over here. So it's a soup and sandwich lunch, and please sign up at the Welcome Center in the back if you would like to join. Also, the women's prayer group is going to have their secret prayer partner reveal and redraw party this week. It's on Thursday, January 13th at 6:30 in the Fireside Room. So please bring a card to reveal yourself, and this is open to all the ladies, whether you were part of the prayer reveal this time or not. Please feel free to join us. Last thing is that we've got a memorial service for Don Wood. That's going to be scheduled for next Thursday, January 20th. It's going to be at 1:30 here at Lynchwood. So now I'd like to call up Jim Weems for a missions update.
Well, it's going to be a little bit more than an update, but I felt like a college student when I woke up this morning and still hadn't completed this little thing I had to share with you. This is maybe the seventh or eighth version that I finally had to stop with, and after I got two pages, I went to sleep last night and finished this morning and thought I was going to be here 10 minutes early, Brian. But I got here right at 10 o'clock. I'm going to share with you this morning. This is, I served an extra year on my missions committee term, but I had volunteered to do this month, and thought Patty kind of gave me a little bit of liberty, so it's going to be kind of a missions moment. At first, I had this tremendous thought. You know, I should share about Stan and Marion Hoffman when they went to Uganda. But no, that wasn't it. Then I thought, well, I can share about my story with Stan and Marion Hoffman in 1991. No, I don't want to draw attention to myself. I want the attention to be on the Lord. So I ended up settling on this little book called Green Leaf and Drought, and tried to, you know, from 100 and something pages down to 10 minutes. And it's the book about the story of the last of the China Inland missionaries that left China after the communist takeover in 1949. As they were arriving, there was actually missionaries and other people thinking that it was time to leave, to evacuate, to get out of here, in case things got really bad. But they were called by a church. They had the government approval on the documents, so they went. And they start out, chapter 11 is the focus. You should have saw the little things I had in my book, little tabs. But I thought chapter 11 really is the some of their story. Let me get here. It starts out with chapter 11 of Hebrews. The honor roll of faith, you know. And the Phillips, which renders thus, they were killed by stoning, being sawn in two, and they were killed with the sword. Right in the middle of this is this little verse that says, they were tempted by specious promises of release. And specious comes from the Latin speciosus, which means good looking. Webster's dictionary says two meanings, showy, and then apparently but deceptively fair, just or correct. So in January of 1951, they applied for exit visas to leave China. And they thought that that would just go so smoothly, but it didn't. They were promised many times that you're going to leave today. You're going to leave today. Their money was no longer given by the China Inland Missionary Board. It was sent to the police, and Arthur had to go to the police of that province that he was at, city, and request his monthly stipend. And of course, they kind of made a joke of it. Oh, it's not here yet. And so he'd have to walk back to his home. And at that time, he had to walk by the execution grounds where they were killing people. And, you know, fearing for his life, but the Lord seemed to keep his heart in perfect peace. So it was six times that they were promised or inferred that they would leave. And the first thing was, you know, that when they said they were to go, they were to get their passes and they were to get their tickets to leave. And one time it was, okay, buy your tickets, and then at 11 o'clock in the morning, we'll give you your passes. So thinking this was real, they actually went and bought their passes to leave, spending almost all their money, and moving in with another family for 4 days, and boom. They had the bus tickets, but the passes didn't come. And so once again, they were disappointed. Well, I wanted to say this. They arrived in China with their little girl, Lila, 1 year old. And they were promised this big compound, majority of it, because there was a gospel church, there was a medical facility, a big kitchen. But when they arrived, a Chinese doctor kind of taken over. And they were given this little room far off to the side, away from the kitchen heat and all other heat. So they had the chilly winter to face and the heat of the summer. And boy, missed my notes. And so a lot of times it would be, you know, that months before they would get a reply for their request to leave or for their request for money. Arthur called his request to go get funds and being denied as his monthly belly crawl to the police, you know, because they wanted him truly submissive, and they loved to make fun of him. But they were kind of disappointed. Arthur, they were showed their place to live, and Wilda was just like, we were promised this whole inner courtyard, and here's this two-story building, and it's lovely. And then when the Chinese pastor showed them where they're going to live, they were like, well, this isn't quite what we were promised. Unbeknownst to them, that when they were invited, by the time they got there, things had changed dramatically. Another Chinese doctor taken over, and that was his place to live now. And they were relegated to the small space. And so after more than 2 years, Wilda and Lila left Arthur for Hong Kong. And on March 24th, 1953, they crossed the Liberty Bridge into Hong Kong. Six times they were promised to leave for Hong Kong, and it was on the seventh time that the promise was fulfilled. Significant number. Arthur was a doctor, and he was forced to stay there because a couple of his patients had accused him. Well, a couple of his patients had died, and their families accused him of murder. Serious charge. After days of public trial, his sentence was everlasting deportation to be put into effect immediately. July 23rd, 1953, Arthur arrived in Hong Kong without passport or money. And he and another man was the last of the China Inland missionaries. China Inland Missions was at that time, or in previous years, the largest Protestant missionary organization in China. At one time, they had over 1,300 missionaries there. Maybe you heard of the Cambridge Seven, where the students at Cambridge University felt a call to go to China. And it started with one or two, and it kept growing. D.L. Moody went to preach, and many others got converted and decided that's where they were to go. But mainly it's a story of the promises, the disappointments, the sufferings. And I thought during this past couple of years, we could kind of all identify with that. We're in this pandemic. Oh, we promised that we're going to get this, and it's going to go away. Then it's like the next day, no, it may last for a little bit longer. You just need one vaccine. Now you need two. Now three, possibly. Oh, there's a new strain. Oh, there's another new strain. And, you know, our emotions are like up and down. Where are we going to go? But, you know, in the midst of all this pandemic stuff, we have to remember that God is on his throne. And there is no panic in heaven with him. He has a purpose, just as he has a purpose, had a purpose with Arthur and Wilson Matthews. And at one time, you know, I attributed the growth of the Chinese church. At one time, they had 50,000 house churches in communist China. And how did that happen? Because they got to see the lives of the Christian life truly lived out in their midst. And that's the story. We never know. But there's missions and there's tremendous need around the world. Father, just hold up our missionaries, our lives, our church into your hands. They're the same hands that were holding Arthur and Will and Matthews and their little daughter while they were suffered from hunger and made to go without, made to do things that they never thought they would have to do. But yet, they submitted to thy will. And they also had to learn, Lord, to delight in thy will. But we wonder, why couldn't God have just saved them, taken them out when they were? But God has a purpose, and we never know what that is. But in his time, it is revealed. Thank you, Jesus. Amen.
Thank you, Jim, for sharing that. So you're probably going to do another prayer?
Yeah, no, of course.
All right, let's do another one, guys. Everyone, please bow your heads here in prayer. Dear Lord, thank you so much for this day. Thank you for this cold but nice, clear day. We all appreciate seeing the sun every once in a while. I just pray that you would open up our hearts and minds today, Lord, to hear your message, to hear what you're trying to say to us through Pastor Brian, and just to connect deeper to you throughout all the songs and all the moments that we have with you today, Lord. Help us to be grateful and help us to really seek you in the midst of all of this. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen.
Would you please stand?
There's a place where mercy reigns and never dies. And there's a place where streams of grace flow deep and wide, where all the love I've ever comes like a flood, comes flowing down. At the cross, I surrender my life. I'm in all of you, I'm in all of you. Where your love ran red and your sin washed white, I owe all to you. Thank you. is a place where sin and shame are powerless, where my heart has peace with God and forgiveness, where all the love I've ever found comes like a flood, comes flowing down. At the cross, I surrender my life. I'm in all of you, I'm in all of you. Sin washed white, I owe all to you, I owe all to you. And here my hope is found, here on holy ground. Here I bow down, here I bow down, here arms open wide, here you saved my life. Here I bow down, here I bow at the cross, I surrender my life. I'm in all of you, I'm in all of you. Where you love and red, and my sin washed white, I owe all to you, I owe all to you. Worthy is the Lamb who was slain. Holy, holy is He. And sing a new song to Him who sits on heaven's mercy seat. Sing, worthy is the Lamb. And worthy is the Lamb who was slain, holy, holy is He. And sing a new song to Him who sits on heaven's mercy seat. And holy, holy, holy is the Lord God Almighty, was and is and is to come. With all creation I sing praise to the King of Kings. You are my everything and I will adore you. In rainbows of living color, flashes of lightning, rolls of thunder, blessing and honor, strength and glory and power be to you, the only wise King. Yeah. Holy, holy, holy is the Lord God Almighty, who was and is and is to come. With all creation I sing praise to the King of Kings. You are my everything and I will adore you. Filled with wonder, awestruck wonder at the mention of your name. Jesus, your name is power, breath and living water, such a marvelous mystery. Yeah. Holy, holy, holy is our Lord God Almighty, who was and is and is to come. With all creation I sing praise to the King of Kings. You are my everything, and I will adore you. And I will adore you. He leadeth me, oh blessed thought, oh words with heavenly comfort fraught. Whate'er I do, where'er I be, still 'tis God's hand that leadeth me. He leadeth me, he leadeth me, by his own hand he leadeth me. His faithful follower I would be, for by his hand he leadeth me. Lord, I would clasp thy hand in mine, nor ever murmur or repine. Content whatever, Lord, I see, since 'tis my God who leadeth me. He leadeth me, he leadeth me, by his own hand he leadeth me. His faithful follower I would be, for by his hand he leadeth me. And when my task on earth is done, when by thy grace the victory's won, in death's cold wave I will not flee, still down through Jordan leading me. He leadeth me, he leadeth me, by his own hand he leadeth me. His faithful follower I would be, oh, by his hand he leadeth me.
You may be seated.
I was telling Terry at the Bible study, this song has been on my mind for the last 3 weeks, actually 2 weeks at that time. He leadeth me, and when my task on earth is done, think of that. When your days are over, he's got them numbered. And when my task on earth is done, when by his grace the victory's won, in death's cold wave I will not flee, still God through Jordan leadeth me. Isn't that great? That's the great hope we have. That excites me. Does it excite you? Great. Well, God is here by his Spirit. He's here and resided in each of our hearts. We need to look to him today as we pray and lift up the various people that are on that list that you were handed as you came in. On the back side of that sheet, it says, it gives their names to you. So I'll not repeat those, but those people need your prayer, and they are depending on you to pray. Let's go ahead and go to the Father. Father, we come into your throne room this morning because we know that you are the God who leads us. You are the God who has given us hope through your Son, Jesus Christ. The Bible says Christ is our hope, is our joy, and is our peace. He is our comforter. He is the one who walks beside us. It is so good, God, to be led through this life, because without it, we are just wanderers, not knowing which way to turn. But with Christ leading us and the Spirit in us, we know which way to turn, which way to go, because you enlighten our hearts. You give us wisdom in the choices we make. So we are thankful, God, for your personal involvement in our life. Now today we realize there are a lot of people who have needs in their lives, both physical and spiritual, and we would lift them up before you. And we'd ask, oh God, that you would comfort them and give them guidance, give them peace in the choices they're making, and may they know a closer relationship with you as they depend upon you to lead them. We would pray today, too, for the leaders of our land. We think of President Biden. We think of Kamala Harris. We think of those that are in leadership in the Senate and in the Congress, in the House. Father, we pray for wisdom to be granted to them. This is a day where our leaders need wisdom. And we are told in Romans 13 that we are to pray for those who rule over us. And that sometimes is difficult to do because we disagree with a policy or a procedure or something that has disturbed our spirit. But we nevertheless are to pray for them, and we are to pray for them to be granted from you wisdom. We're prayed for them for their health and for their well-being. And to lift them before you, because they have not come into the place they are by accident, but it's by divine design. We sometimes forget that. We forget that those who are in leadership have actually been allowed to assume that position because of you and your sovereignty. And we don't know why that is, but we know that all things work together to good to those who love the Lord and are called according to his purpose. And we are a people who are called according to your purpose. We are not just ad hoc beings on this earth. We are here for a purpose. And we depend upon you to lead us into the right way and to do the right thing. So bless us as we continue our service today. May our hearts be open to receive your word as you bring it to us. Far beyond what our pastor will say, you will speak into our hearts. May our hearts be open to that. We ask all these things in Jesus' name. Amen.
Would you please stand? My Jesus, I love thee. I know thou art mine. For thee all the follies of sin I resign. My gracious Redeemer, my Savior art thou. If ever I love thee, my Jesus, tis now. I love thee because thou hast first loved me and purchased my pardon on Calvary's tree. I love thee for wearing the thorns on thy brow. If ever I love thee, my Jesus, 'tis now. I love thee in life, I will love thee in death, and praise thee as long as thou handest me bread, and say when the death dew lies cold on my brow, if ever I love thee, my Jesus, 'tis now. In mansions of glory and endless delight, I'll ever adore thee in heaven so bright. I'll sing the glittering crown on my
best is now. Maybe see it.
The stomping is your cue, kiddos. You're released. Good morning. As we were singing that song, I've had the privilege of being married for 15 years. And, you know, once you're done dating, you all have the opportunity to move from love to pattern, don't you? You just kind of go through the motions. And one day you wake up and you're like, well, I can do better than this. Don't let that be our hearts toward the Lord. You hear me? Did you come today for a pattern? Did you come because it's Sunday? Or did you come because it's the Lord's day? Awaken and join with me in the Word today. Open your Bibles to Hebrews chapter 12. Verse 14. Pursue peace with all men and be holy. For without holiness, no one will see the Lord. Let that fester for a little while with you. Without holiness, no one will see the Lord. Let's pray. Lord, I just want to echo the prayer of Brother Carl that you would speak so much beyond anything that I say today. May the words of a mere mortal be simply an avenue of your spirit to speak and to minister and to move in each of our lives. Lord, I ask today that we would come to a greater understanding that our God is not a philosophy. He is not a religion. He is alive. And he's here today. It's the God who loved us and gave himself up for us, that we may have a new life in Jesus. Amen. Go ahead and grab your Bibles. Turn back to Matthew chapter 3. We'll be there in just a little bit. Before we get there, I want to read a quote to you. This was written by someone that I know, so we'll call it an anonymous quote. I won't say who it is. But this is entitled, Other Morality. See if you get a kick out of this. Other morality is the shift in focus from one's personal moral construction and fine-tuning to those of others. This behavior is built upon the belief that total moral clarity on all complex human social matters can be known. In addition, they believe that not all people have the same ability to reach such a clarity, and that it is their responsibility to teach others of where they fall short in the ideal moral person. The other moral person has fully completed their moral training, providing them with the highest degree of clarity on even the most impossibly complex social issues of our time. And with their moral knowledge of the world now complete, their attention can be focused outwardly to the underdeveloped world that surrounds them. This new individual, now armed with this powerful moral wisdom, finds it to be their duty, if not their highest purpose, to use the powerful moral binoculars to be on the hunt for any and all moral failings of those around them, strangers and family alike, and to communicate those observations by any means available in order to ensure that their moral status may be known by as many as possible. This was written several years ago, and it has played out to be, I think, fairly true. You know, it is interesting, and I don't think I have much argument when I say that we live in a blame society. We live in a time in which we rapidly want to take responsibility for the things that we are successful in, and we rapidly want to pass blame for all the things that we fail in. We actually had a small miracle in the Arnold household last night. the kids were getting ready for bed, and one of my boys walks down, and he said, "Dad, I took responsibility." I said, "Really? What happened?" "Well, Mom said, who threw the pillows on the floor of the couch?" And I said, "It was me." And I walked over, and I picked them up, and I put them back. And we've been working on taking responsibility for a while here. It's been a hard fight. And he says, "It's a new world record." I was like, "What's a world record?" One time I took responsibility. It's a new world record, Dad. Ah! The rest of the night, they got a good joke out of saying, "It was me!" I even got someone to confess to going to the bathroom on the toilet seat. It's amazing. We don't like to take responsibility for failures. And we do live in a time when I don't think it's a stretch to say that blame and deflection, rather than confession and responsibility, are the primary virtues of what happens around us. And so my question this morning to you is simple. What about you? Can we as the people of God come to a place in our lives where we own it? That's not to say there aren't issues. That's not to say that other people aren't problems or don't have problems. Because there are many failings of many. But we're included in the list, are we not? And can we wrestle with the reality that God has work to do in us too? And turn those binoculars around. Well, don't turn them around, it just makes everything further away. But turn the scope on us and say, "Lord, the world's busted, but I'm here. What would you have of me?" Matthew chapter 3 is the introduction to the ministry of Jesus, and this section is about the one you know as John the Baptist. And this is as Jesus was just beginning to come into his public ministry. Actually, before that, he says this. He says, "Now in those days, John the Baptist came, preaching in the wilderness of Judea, saying, 'Repent, for the kingdom of heaven is at hand.' For this is the one referred to by Isaiah the prophet when he said, 'The voice of the one crying in the wilderness, make ready the way of the Lord and make its path straight.' Now John himself had a garment of camel's hair and a leather belt around his waist. His food was locusts and honey." There is such thing as a locust tree, so maybe not grasshoppers. "And when Jerusalem was going out to him, and all of Judea and the district around the Jordan, and they were all being baptized by him in the Jordan River as they confessed their sins. But when he saw many of the Pharisees and the Sadducees coming for baptism, he said to them, 'You brood of vipers, who warned you to flee from the wrath to come? Therefore, bear fruit in keeping with repentance. Do not suppose that you can say to yourselves, "We have Abraham for our father." For I say to you that from these stones, God is able to raise up children of Abraham. The axe is already laid at the root of the trees. Therefore, every tree that does not bear good fruit is cut down and is thrown into the fire. But as for me, I baptize you with water for repentance. But he who is coming after me is mightier than I. I am not fit to remove his sandals. He will baptize you with the Holy Spirit and with fire. His winnowing fork is in his hand, and he will thoroughly clear the threshing floor. And he will gather the wheat into the barn, but he will burn up the chaff with an unquenchable fire." Last week, we took a little spiritual inventory. And it's we start a new year. The starting of a new year is a time of introspection. It's a time of reflection. And we kind of took this spiritual inventory. And the next step is, where do we go from here? In this new beginning, where do we begin? And I want to talk to you this morning about this word, repentance. Repentance, quite simply, means change, but it's more than that. It is the ability to look back. How many of you guys have reflected back? To look back and to see error, and in the midst of seeing error, to change the way that we think or change the way that we behave in order to realign with what's right. How many of you have ever looked back at any point in your life and went, "Oops"? Okay? That's the first step. The next step is, okay, how do I correct this, right? And it has to do with shaping the way that we think, what we believe, to align our mind is what's right. You guys ever had wrong thinking? All of a sudden, you got to go back and kind of rebuild your mental framework. You have wrong thinking, and you have wrong action, and realignment. And repentance is the starting point. This is so important, you guys. Repentance truly is the starting point of the next move of God. It's the starting point. You want to see the Lord move, it begins here. John the Baptist, it says right here, he says he was called to prepare the way, to go before that which Jesus was going to do. There was something in the divine order that John was prophesied 700 years earlier by the prophet Isaiah, saying, even before the Messiah comes, there's going to be one who comes who prepares the way, and his message is repentance, because something needed to happen in human hearts to open them up to what the Lord wanted to do. You know, I don't think it is by accident that several of Jesus' disciples were John's disciples first. And would they have ever been Jesus' disciples if they weren't John's disciples first? If they had not learned to humble themselves, look back and say, you know what? I'm not sure all the right directions quite yet, but I'm recognizing this. Something is off. And I'm going to begin to do whatever I can to change the way that I think, to change the way that I live, because I'm going to realign myself with what's right. And in doing that, open themselves up to being able to walk with Jesus as one of his closest friends. You know, I'm not a historian, though I wish I was, because I think history is really cool. But I would argue with you that nearly all of the major moves of God, we have things that God shows up and God violates all rules, right? That didn't sound right. God makes rules, but where God shows up, but nearly all great moves of God in life, all throughout history, they begin with a people who learn to repent. Go all the way back to the judges. You see this pattern, right? Every time God moves, it's moving on the heels of people who say, we missed it. It's time to set it straight. Same thing happened in the exiles when Assyria or even Babylon took over. There was a part of repentance in which realigned them with the Lord, and he began to move. Jesus' ministry began with repentance. We look at the Reformation. We look at the revivals, the first and second Great Awakening, Azusa Street. They began with this brokenness of heart, this willingness to reflect and say, something's not right, and it's time to make it right, to rethink how we live. You know, I want to take a moment this morning and just share a little bit. We have some bad theology when it comes to repentance. And I want to just break some of that down, because repentance is kind of this word that we use for someone who has never been in the church before and they're this terrible office sinner and they've all these things wrong and the really bad person needs to repent. But me, you know, I repented a long time ago and I'm good. Bad theology. Okay, let's talk a little bit this morning about what repentance looks like, whether you are first day ever even thinking about setting your life straight, or Jesus, or the scriptures, or whatever it is, or whether you have been in the church for 80 years, because it applies to all of us. First thing I want to tell you is that true repentance is fruitful, not regretful. Follow me here. It is fruitful, not regretful. What does Jesus say to these Pharisees and Sadducees as they come? He says, when he saw many of the Pharisees and Sadducees, these are the religious leaders of the day, okay? These Jewish religious leaders coming for baptism, he said, you brood of vipers, who warned you to flee from the wrath to come? Bear fruit in keeping with repentance. What was going on with these people? So John the Baptist is... people are coming from all over to hear John preach, which is really quite remarkable, because John probably didn't have a lot of fluffy things to say. John was a preacher of the judgment of God and even the wrath of God, and this the preacher saying, hey, it's time to turn your life around and get your life straight, and people were coming all over to hear it. I actually wonder what percent of modern-day evangelical churches in the United States would even let John come close to their pulpit. He'd be a hate preacher by many standards, even in evangelical churches today. I'm not telling you to go preach like John the Baptist. It was his call. But he had hard messages. And here these people are coming out, and he can see through them that their heart isn't in it. We have a term we use today, it's called virtue signaling. It's when you can make a public appearance that makes you align with something that is socially acceptable so that you can save face, but when it comes to actually putting that into practice, it's nowhere to be found. That's what was going on with these men. There was this big following that was going after John because they were hearing him speak, and they were hearing him share about things that they were beginning to recognize that were in the wrong, and it was even discrediting leaders, all the way up to Herod. John pulled no punches. All the way up to the leadership of the land, and of course the religious leaders. And so as an effort to save face, because all of these people are getting baptized, they said, well, we better get baptized too, otherwise people are going to reject us. And he calls them out on it. Because he saw that their lives actually weren't changing. What they wanted to do is they wanted to say sorry and for everything to be okay again. You ever have a parent who told you, or a grandparent, when you mess up and you say, I'm sorry, and they say, I'm sorry is not good enough? I remember being like 9. I'm like, I said I'm sorry. What more can I do? Like, I'm sorry. And now as a parent, I totally understand why I'm sorry is not good enough. Because I don't care about your words. I want you to actually change. That's repentance. You see, we have a bad theology around repentance that thinks if I feel bad, if I say I'm sorry, that's repentance. It's not what the scripture teaches. And I'm not going to spend too much time here because it's blatantly obvious, but true repentance is an action. There is a change that comes about. Now, a lot of times we have trouble discerning what that change is going to be. I'm going to talk about that in a second. But it's the recognition, and it's a changed life. Regret says, I wish I hadn't. That's regret. That's not repentance. Regret says, I wish I hadn't. Repentance says, I will. I am. And it's a change. It's a real change. Let's push a little bit deeper. It is also thoughtful. Well, let's call it this. It's also reflective, not reactive. It's reflective, not reactive. In other words, true repentance takes mental power. It takes analysis. Analysis. That's a much better English word that I can use there. Thank you. Appreciate that. It requires discernment because it doesn't come easy. You know, one of the great ironies of repentance is this, that sometimes in an effort to repent, we can actually repent to something that's just as bad because we react rather than reflect and respond. Probably one of the ways in which you've seen this, and let's go ahead and just jump right into politics and government and all that fun stuff, okay? Is in the Me Too movement. You guys are familiar with the Me Too movement? The Me Too movement is basically the dealing with sexual assault in our society, which is a real problem. It's a huge problem, and it has been for a very long time. And what people began to recognize is that women were being victimized and no one was being held accountable and women were not being protected. And so what we do, we said, this is wrong. This can't happen. Women cannot be victimized. So we reacted, and now all of a sudden, right, we have the movement that a mere accusation ruins your life. You guys know that's true. Because we're so adamant on protecting women, now there are people, and I personally know a person that has had decades of integrity, was accused by someone who did not have decades of integrity, and his whole life is thrown upside down. Because it is one of those places now in our society in which you are guilty until proven innocent. We've seen it play out. Now, there's a real problem. Again, I'm not saying there's not a real problem with this, but what we've done is we have repented. Yes, we have changed, maybe, but we didn't change to the right course. It's like if we were supposed to go north, we were headed west, we just did the opposite. And so now we're going east, but east is still not north, because we have to really reflect and we have to really dive deep in these hard things in life. of how to make it right. You know, one of the reasons that we're so messed up right now, I think, and we have so much division, is because we have two political parties that are reacting to one another instead of responding to the needs of the people. You know, the border. Well, it's inhumane to close it. Well, it's wrong to keep it open. Racism. There's no such thing as racism. You're making it up. Racism is everywhere and it controls everything. They're both equally wrong, guys. COVID response. Everybody must give me my freedom. And we're reacting to one another rather than really trying to discern. We're thinking that because this is wrong, if I simply do the opposite, I'll be in the right. But that's not true. The opposite of what's wrong is not necessarily right. And so we don't just do a 180. What we have to do is we have to actually reflect, we have to actually discern, and we have to press in deeper, because true repentance should bring about right response, aka solutions. True repentance should bring out solutions to problems, because it should be a realignment with God and his kingdom and the way the world was designed to operate. You say, okay, Brian, well, you're talking about the political theater. That's a little bit bigger than my sphere. You said at the beginning that we were going to focus on ourselves, and now you're kind of ripping on government. What's the big deal? Let me illustrate it for you, okay? I have a purpose. Okay? When it comes to, let's talk about government, because government and politics are different. Government is for the people, politics is for the politicians, right? One is focused on preserving self, one is for the people. But government itself, one thing that is true in government is that government deals with incredibly complex issues. Incredibly complex issues. A number of circumstances that are beyond anything that we can perceive, and even the people that are governing can conceive. And there are all kinds of factors to consider, and most of the time when it comes to governance, there is no black and white. There is no matter of fact, this is wrong, matter of fact, this is right. There's this giant area in the middle that's gray. And what we have to learn to do in the gray is we have to learn to discern God's best. In a place in which there's no perfect answers, or it doesn't feel like there's a perfect answer, is there a best? Is there a place that we can live into that? Now, when we're talking about repentance, like, again, we think of the big sins. It's like if you're stealing, or if you're having an adulterous relationship, or you're into pornography, or drug abuse, or spousal abuse, or you're into fraud, it's like, okay, you could probably turn the opposite direction from that and hit something a little better than what you're hitting, okay? But the reality, the truth of the matter is that repentance in our lives is often in the gray areas of life, because we are in constant reality of searching for the will of God in the hard, complex, interpersonal places of our life where we can manifest the love of God in his holy will. You know, if you have a Ten Commandments style morality, a lot of times our standard that we set for ourselves is, well, that wasn't a sin, so I'm good. I didn't break one of the Ten Commandments, so I'm good. So leave the rest of it out. Right? When it comes to our lives, are we called to live in a place where we can say, that wasn't sin, or are we called to holiness? You know, how do I manage my money? Well, I mean, I spend some, and I don't contribute to anything that's illegal, and I put a little bit in savings, and you can look at my whole checkbook. I did not spend on anything that's sinful. See, no sin. Is that a different standard than holiness? Say, Lord, you've given me these resources. What do I do? Where do I invest? Where do I give? How do I manage my time? Well, look, you can see, you can follow me on my watch. I've been everywhere. Look, I've exercised. There's nothing on here that's sinful. See, I'm good. Is that a different standard than holiness? And living your life in those moments My good friend Ralph Minden always says, every appointment is a divine appointment. We think of these times in life when it's like, oh, God shows up, wow. But what if every appointment is a divine appointment? How do we spend our time? I was talking earlier about caring for our spouse. How do you love your spouse? Well, I'm still wearing my ring, aren't I? Is that the fulfillment of your vows? Is that the best we can do? And what about being a parent? And parenting changes as seasons of life change, doesn't it? Are we not always trying to learn and discern and reflect back and say, how do I do it better, Lord? How do I live in your holiness? How do I live in the law of love? Because the law of government is so different from the law of love. The law of government says, if you don't do these things, you're righteous. But the law of love is all about action. It's the golden rule. We talked about that several weeks ago, months ago. Do unto others as you would have them do to you. It's a call to action. The holiness of life. How am I as an employee? Well, I clocked in and I clocked out, and no one can say anything bad about my performance. Did you serve your boss as you serve the Lord? That's the call. You know, and I'm not trying to overwhelm you with this call of holiness or this call of perfection, but what I am saying is that life is a very, very complex thing. And having the standard of, well, I didn't sin, is not the standard that we're called to. We're called to this standard of living out the law of love, in which we must have the spirit of love, which is the Holy Spirit, guiding and directing us. He leadeth me. He leadeth me. And it's a hard walk. It's a discerning walk. It is, Jesus talks about separating the wheat from the chaff. Actually, John the Baptist says when Jesus comes, he's going to separate the wheat and the chaff. These two things that are so close together, but if there's chaff in your bread, how's that going to taste? Being able to separate that which is edible from that which is not, that which brings nourishment to that which is just fluff. And so often, even in my life, it's just fluff. No, you're not going to look at it and say, wow, sin, 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 pastor, boy, you really need to repent. But when I look at my own life, when I really begin to reflect rather than just react, and I begin to open myself up to the Lord, I find that he begins to lead me in amazing ways when my standard is no longer just the Ten Commandments, not about what I didn't do, but rather what I did with all that God has given me. See, repentance is not just for the one who's living this hardened life and is finally coming to realize their come-to-Jesus moment. Repentance is for all of us. It's the beginning of a journey that says, Lord, I'm yours. What would you have me do? It is reflective, church. It is not reactive. And here's the last one I want to hit this morning. It's God-centered, not man-centered. It is God-centered, not man-centered. And this is hugely important. In other words, when we recognize, whether it's a little change or whether it's a big change, and we recognize, when we reflect back and go, that's not right, we are aligning ourselves with Jesus Christ, not with people. See, if I find out that I'm going west and I need to go north, okay, north had better be Jesus, not your buddy. We do not align with other people. We align ourselves with the Lord first. There's a really interesting passage in Psalm chapter 51. Psalm chapter 51 is this psalm that David writes after Nathan busts him for a terrible sin with Bathsheba, okay? So if you don't know the story, David is king of Israel. He's up on his roof. He's at roof. He's a peeping Tom. He sees a hottie bathing. He says, hey, go get her. They bring this woman up to him, and you can fill in the rest by yourself. She gets pregnant, and then he realizes, uh-oh, I'm in trouble. Her husband was on the battlefield. He sends word, brings Uriah, her husband, back, gets him drunk so that he'll hopefully go back and sleep with his wife to cover up his tracks. He doesn't do it, and so he realizes, I'm not getting out of this. He sends a letter back with Uriah, back to Joab, his commander. It says, put him in the front of the lines and pull back. He won't see the dawn of morning again. And he writes this really interesting verse in Psalm 51, verse 4, as he's repenting to the Lord. He says, against you and you only have I sinned and done what's right in your sight. excuse me, against you and only you have I sinned and done what is evil in your sight. Now, David, I don't mean to be a little overly critiquing here. Only against God have you sinned? Are you sure about that? Like, do you kind of have an idea of what you did to Bathsheba, Mr. King? Uriah probably has a different story than you do. What about Joab, your hitman? What about that guy? Did you sin against them? And yet he comes back to this place where he says, you and you only have I done evil, and what is your sight? Clearly David's mistaken in such a statement, isn't he? Well, yes and no. Yes, the fact that David did sin against other people, but here's the catch. In this first place of brokenness, he has one primary concern, and that is to align himself back with his Heavenly Father. It doesn't mean that there is not restoration that needs to happen on a personal level, but it is to align ourselves back to our Heavenly Father, to align ourselves with God's will, not the will of others. Let's just jump in a little bit deeper here. You know, one of these days we may talk about critical theory a little bit more in the church, because it's something that is shaping our society severely. You probably heard of critical race theory. That's just a child of critical theory. But what it is in its conception is it's a atheistic and humanistic worldview that is shaping much of our governments, much of our entertainment industry, a lot of our educational institutions, and our businesses, especially big business. Okay, and it's a little bit elusive, because every time you say something, there's no Bible on it, so they're like, that's not what we believe, but you can't really go to the Bible. But anyway, this is a philosophy of mind and a philosophy of life where there is no God, and instead, we are God. We have put, you go back to the history of it, the whole thing was conceived to destroy Western civilization that is God-centric and make man the center of reality. So what happens to a people who think of themselves as God when they are offended at what we do? There's a story in the book of Daniel where Nebuchadnezzar, who is the king, captures these three, well, they captured a lot of people, but three of them were Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego. Okay. And he sets up this golden image. King Nebuchadnezzar sets up this huge golden image in Babylon. He says, whenever the band plays, I want you to bow down and I want you to worship this image. And so the band plays, and all these people in his kingdom, they all bow down and they worship this image, except for these three guys who are nuts. And they decide to take on the king. And they don't bow down and they don't worship him. And what was the consequences for not bowing down and worshiping the idol that the king had set up? Death by the fiery furnace. Why was the result of not worshiping this image? Why was the consequence death? Because Nebuchadnezzar believed himself to be a god. And when you offend a god, you are guilty of eternal sin. Okay? We are now living in a day in which we are all being trained that we're God. And we are usurping the throne of God, and we are standing in his place and saying, the world revolves around me. Therefore, if you offend me, what are you guilty of? Eternal sin. You following me here? And this is why it's so important that we recognize to whom we repent and to whom we align, because there is no amount of repentance that can make a world content that believes when you offend them, you are guilty of sin. I can't overemphasize this enough, you guys. We will never repent enough to appease a people who have put themselves in the position of God and says the world needs to revolve around me. We will never repent enough. It's a mark that's always changing, and it will be impossible to align. We must come to a place where we say, Lord, Jesus Christ is the center of my life and the center of my aim. He is my true north. He is the one that came, that revealed the Father, that gave himself up for me, that died on the cross that I might live. And now I will give myself to him. I will align myself to the way, the truth, and the life. I will align myself to love in flesh. I will align myself to the risen Savior. You know, we are being pushed on every side to conform. We are pushed on every side to not offend, to not hurt, to go along with whatever anybody thinks is right and what is wrong. But it's different from everybody because we're living in a time when people are placing themselves in the throne of God, and we must not place them there. It doesn't mean we don't love them. It doesn't mean we don't respect them. It doesn't mean we don't take them seriously, but they are not God. We align ourselves with Jesus Christ. And so my question this morning, worship team, you can come as we close. Repentance. What are you after? If you're after a list that says, you can't prove that I sinned, none of these things are sinful, I kept the Ten Commandments, I did them right, like the rich young ruler. I've done all this since I was a youth, I'm good. If you're after a list, God's going to basically say what I didn't do. Or is our heart holiness? What do we read at the beginning? Be holy, for without holiness, what? No one can see the Lord. There's a foundational framework and an openness of the heart when we're willing to come to God just like this. I don't even know what the answer is, Lord, because there's a lot of complex stuff going on. I wish I knew all the answers. Not really, because then people would call me all the time. Be terrible. I wish I knew more answers than I do. But can we humble ourselves and say, you know, there's better. Lord, keep realigning me. Keep realigning me. Keep bringing me back. Bringing me back. Bringing me back. Because repentance is not something that we do once and forget it. It's a lifestyle of saying, Lord, align me with your will because I want to walk in holiness. It's fruitful. It's not regretful. It's reflective. It's not reactive. And it's always God-centered, not man-centered. Jesus, we ask for your grace to start over. And it doesn't begin with our willpower. It doesn't begin with our strength. It begins with our confession. It begins by a place of owning our own mistakes. Saying, Lord, what would you have me do? Amen.
Would you please stand?
Create in me a clean heart, O God, and renew a right spirit within me. Create in me a clean heart, O God, and renew a right spirit within me. Cast me not away from your presence, O Lord, and take not your Holy Spirit from me. Restore unto me the joy of thy salvation, and renew a right spirit within me. Spirit within me, create in me a clean heart, O God, and renew a right spirit within me, and cast me not away
from thy presence, O Lord, and take not your Holy Spirit from me. Restore unto me the joy of thy salvation, and renew a right spirit within me.
The day of Pentecost, Peter got up and he spoke to a crowd. And as he shared, that Jesus had risen from the dead, and they all were like, yeah, we saw him too. It's a little bit crazy. And it says they were cut to the quick because they recognized what he was saying is true. They said, what do we do? And Peter gave him two things to do. He said, repent and be baptized. And again, what he was calling them to was not, hey, feel bad and go take a bath. He invited them into a process that was never going to end. He invited them into a place where I want you to abandon the status quo. I want you to abandon those things that you've done just because they were done before you. Do not assume that because your father was Abraham that you're somehow in. I want you to think. I want you to pray. I want you to meditate. I want you to strive after holiness, to live out the law of love of Christ. That's the beginning of the journey. That is the beginning of nearly every profound move of God, not only corporately, not only publicly, but in our own lives too, is that God moves in a broken and contrite spirit. And if you don't know what the right choice is yet, be content in saying, Lord, I know this isn't it. I'm open. Lead me. And listen. Let me pray for you. Jesus, we confess that this world is too complex for us, and the law of love is too high for us to live in the flesh. But we can reflect back and know where we've missed it, and we can look forward and not know how to fix it. And so we just ask for a simple humility tonight, that we would be a people who are drawn back to a humbleness. Say, Lord, help us to be our true north and to be content in looking to you. In Jesus' name, amen. I have a couple announcements. I don't think it was mentioned earlier. I am personally teaching a core class, and this is a Think Link. It's a short-term small group. We're going to be meeting at Abora's house. Abora's back here. Starting a week from tomorrow, 4 weeks, if you have ever wondered exactly what the gospel teaches or what the Bible teaches, the big story, and especially how to share that with today's day and age, I really encourage you to be there. It's 4 weeks. It'll really help you understand the bigger story of what salvation is and what Jesus came to do. Sign-ups at the Welcome Center. The other thing is, in approximately 6 minutes, we're going to be starting discussions over here in the gym, and I'd love to invite you over to join us for the link tables if you want to continue the conversation. You're dismissed.